Sarthyam Arjunasya Adau. Sarthyam Arjunasya Adau. So I'll explain the meaning, then we can recite it. So he became the Sarthi of Arjuna, Sartham Arjunasya Adau, Kuruvan Gita Amrutam Dadau. And he gave the nectar of the Bhagavad Gita. Sarthyam Arjunasya Adau.
Sarthyam Arjunasya Adau.
Kuruvan Gita Amrutam Dadau.
Kuruvan Gita Amrutam Dadau.
Sarthyam Arjunasya Adau.
Sarthyam Arjunasya Adau.
Kuruvan Gita Amrutam Dadau.
Kuruvan Gita Amrutam Dadau.
Lokatrayopakaraya. In this way, he benefited all the three worlds. Lokatrayopakaraya. Tasmai Krishnatmane Namaha.
Tasmai Krishnatmane Namaha.
And to that Krishna, who is the soul of all of existence, I offer obeisances. Lokatrayopakaraya.
Tasmai Krishnatmane Namaha.
Sarthyam Arjunasya Adau. Sarthyam Arjunasya Adau. Kuruvan Gitamrutam Dadau. Gitamrutam Dadau. Lokatrayopakaraya. Yopakaraya. Tasmai Krishnatmane Namaha. One last time. Sarthyam Arjunasya Adau. Sarthyam Arjunasya Adau. Kuruvan Gitamrutam Dadau. Kuruvan Gitamrutam Dadau. Lokatrayopakaraya. Tasmai Krishnatmane Namaha. Om Ajnanati Mirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Desha Tarine Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripasindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. So today we are discussing on the last six chapters of the Bhagavad Gita. In the last two sessions, the first two six chapters and then the 7th to 12 chapters were discussed. This series is going on the occasion of the Gita Jayanti, which is going to be celebrated tomorrow on the occasion of Mokshada Ekadashi. So the 13 to 18 chapters are among the most technical chapters in the Bhagavad Gita. And they comprise what is often called as the jnana section. So the Bhagavad Gita broadly talks about bhakti. The first six chapters talk about how karma leads to bhakti. The middle six chapters focus on bhakti. And the last six chapters talk about how jnana leads to bhakti. So I will take one driving metaphor to analyze the thread of thought that unifies the last six chapters. And that metaphor will be based on 13.22 in the Bhagavad Gita, which is often called as the Bija Vakya, the root of the whole middle six chapters. So, of the last six chapters rather. Now, in this section, if you look at the background, in the 10th chapter, Krishna has spoken the Chatushloki Bhagavad Gita, 10.8 to 11. And after that, Arjuna accepts the essential conclusions of the Gita. In 10.12, 13, 14, he says, Param Brahma, Param Dhamma, Pavitram, Paramam Bhavam. Bhavan, he says, you are the supreme person. Not only you, all the great sages are saying this. Sarvameta dridam manye, I accept everything that you say. Essentially, at this point, Krishna has enlightened Arjuna. And Arjuna is thereafter asking questions, not for his own enlightenment, but for the sake of clarifying concepts which might be confusing. So it's from the 10th chapter onwards, whatever Krishna asks, whatever Arjuna asks, is for helping other people to connect the conclusions of the Gita with various other concepts that were familiar to people at those times. So in the 10th chapter, he asks about the concept of vibhuti. So how can I remember you, Krishna, when we are in the material world and looking at material things? So that he describes in vibhuti yoga. In the 11th chapter, he analyzes the Vishwarupa. He says, please demonstrate the Vishwarupa. So that, if you see in the 11th chapter, second verse, Arjuna essentially says the same thing which he says at the end of the Bhagavad Gita. At the end of the Bhagavad Gita in 18.73, he says, Nashto moha smitir labdha. That, by tat prasadan mayachuta, sito smigata sandeha karishye vachanam tava. That by your mercy, my illusion has been destroyed. And I am situated free from doubt now. So now if you see 11.11 and 11.2, he says the same thing. Madanugraha ya paramam guhyam adhyatma sangitam yattvayoktam vachastena mohoyam vigato mama. Mohoyam vigato mama. Moha is gone. How has it happened? Madanugraha ya paramam, because you have had great mercy on me. So anugraha is what he is using the word here. And 18.73, he uses tat prasadan. So prasad and anugraha are the same thing, mercy. So Krishna is being informed by Arjuna that now I am enlightened. What I am asking you is for the benefit of others. So the 11th chapter he asks about the Virata Rupa. Then the 12th chapter he asks about the personal and impersonal conceptions. So there is no direct connection between 11, 12, 13 chapters. We can trace a connection, but it is just like after a class is over, you know, if five people ask questions, it's not that the five questions are going to be connected with each other. So we can trace a connection if we want to. They're all, so the question, defining questions which begin the 11th chapter, 12th chapter, 13 chapters, they are not necessarily in a linear flow. They are in a thematic connection that what was explained, how do we understand this in this light? How do we understand this in this light? So the 13th chapter begins with a question. Now, the question is about certain terms which were common in the culture at that time, in the philosophical circles at that time. What do those terms mean? So he asks about, in 13.1, six terms he asks about. He asks about what is Purusha, what is Prakriti, what is Kshetra, what is Kshetragya, and what is Jnana and Gyaya. Jnanam Gyayam Cha Keshava. So he says, please tell me about these six things. And the 13th chapter essentially explains these six concepts. So I'll come to these concepts a little later. Let's go to 13.22, which I'll be taking as the bija for the whole metaphor, for explaining the flow of all the six chapters, 13 to 18. So 13.22 is called by our acharyas as the bija vakya. Bija is the seed. So prakriti, purushah prakriti sthohi bhungte prakriti jan gunan karanam guna sangosya sadasad yoni janmasu. Purushah, purusha is the soul. Prakriti sthohi, the soul becomes situated in matter. Why? Bhungte prakriti jan gunan, bhungte, because of desiring to enjoy prakriti jan gunan, the products of material nature. And because of this, karanam guna sanghosya, because of association with the modes of material nature, sad asad yoni janmasu, person takes birth, gets auspicious and inauspicious things in this world. So the soul is spiritual, the body is material. How did the soul get entangled in matter? In fact, in Western philosophical circles, the idea of a soul, which was quite aggressively promoted by a philosopher named René Descartes, it was rejected because he did not have an explanatory framework for explaining how a non-material being can influence matter. He says the behavior of matter, the idea was that we can explain it in terms of physical laws. So how can something which has no mass, which has no weight, how can it exert any force and how can it influence matter? So he himself could not give any answer, and subsequent philosophers also did not give. So Cartesian duality, that was mostly rejected in Western mainstream philosophy. Now the Bhagavad Gita explains that this identification or misidentification of the soul with matter, that happens. How does the soul influence matter? The soul does not influence matter. The soul desires to influence matter, and it is the super soul which acts as the mediator. So to give an example, say somebody wants to watch a movie. Now when, say, if I turn on a TV to watch a movie, I may be sitting in my room comfortably, and it may be a comfortable environment, but if I turn on the TV and then that the movie turns out to be a horror movie. So although suppose somebody is watching a horror movie, now although that person is safe and comfortable in one's own room, but the consciousness is caught in the movie. And because the consciousness is caught in the movie, one may experience fear, horror, terror, and all these emotions come because of the consciousness getting caught. Now if that person wants, if somebody is getting very scared, sometimes some children hear some story and they get very scared, and they see the parents see they're getting scared and say, don't watch it. They'll turn off the TV. But the soul's entanglement in material nature is such that there is no button to easily turn off. So once we start watching the movie, it's just we get caught. Purushaha prakriti stohi. Purushaha, the soul, prakriti stohi, gets caught in material nature. Why? Bhungte prakriti jan gunan. Bhungte, because of the desire to enjoy. And this desire to enjoy, just like when a person wants to watch a movie, there's a desire to enjoy the movie. And that desire transports that person, not physically, but emotionally, from the safe arena wherever one is into the turbulent arena of the movie. So like that, the soul's consciousness gets projected and transported into material existence. And this whole thing is done by the arrangement of a super soul. Now in a movie, normally, I'll start with the metaphor of a movie because it is something which practically all of us are familiar with. But I'll move forward to another metaphor, say of a video game. Now in a movie, we are just spectators. In a video game, we are participants. So when you participate in a video game, what happens is, say, if somebody is playing some video game involving, say, police chasing a thief, then the police have a van and the police are going in a van. And depending on how the player operates the video game, the van will move fast, the van will catch up with the thieves, or the thieves will leave behind. And in a video game, the actions of the video game player are reflected in the actions of the participant of the events on the game. So it is not just a spectator, it is a participant. But if we see the person who is playing the video game, that person needs to know the rules. Okay, this I have to operate this, this will happen. If I do this, this will happen. But at the same time, that person has not, the video game player has not designed the video game. The video game designing requires a far greater intelligence, much of which will not be known to the video game player. Now going further than a video game, in army training or especially Air Force training, often simulations are used. Simulation means artificial replication of a reality. Say for example, a fighter pilot is supposed to bomb a particular location. Now you cannot actually do an experiment and send a fighter pilot and see, drop a bomb, do you drop it accurately or not? You know, that will cause so much collateral damage, so much destruction. So the precision of the training, how well trained the pilot has become, that is tested and demonstrated through simulation. So simulation means the air pilot who is being tested, he will sit in a chair and that chair will be more or less similar to the air pilot's chair in a plane, and then all the sensors are there. It's not just the eyes, but there'll be ear pads, and there'll be leg brakes, seats, rests and brakes for the leg, and there'll be buttons for steering the plane. And everything that the pilot would have done in an actual plane, the pilot will do here in the simulated setup. And whatever the pilot does accordingly, the simulation of the airplane will move accordingly. So in this way, now if the pilot gets very caught in flying that plane, and it's flying that plane, and the airplane in the simulation has gone to the enemy territory. When it has gone to the enemy territory, at that time, suppose an anti-aircraft missile comes and hits the plane, and suddenly the plane explodes in a blaze of fire. So the pilot, who is the trainee air pilot, who is caught in the virtual reality, will experience a virtual death. For that pilot, the pilot is not injured, but because of the misidentification, the one will undergo all those emotions, including the shock of death also. One will not die, but will experience the shock of death. This is what Krishna is saying. Sad asad yoni janmasu. The soul, when the soul identifies with matter, what happens is sad asad yoni. Different kinds of experiences which happen to the body, we feel as if they are happening to us. And the six terms that Krishna explains in this chapter. So Purusha and Prakriti, as I said, is basically soul. Purusha is the soul and the Prakriti is matter. Now in the Purusha, there are two Purushas. Uttama, this is the 22nd verse. 23rd verse says, Uttama Purusha Tvanyaha Paramatmeti Udharuta Yo Lokatrayama Vishya Bibhartya Avyaya Ishvara. So this is one Purusha who is caught in material nature. That was 13.22, but 13.23 Krishna says, Uttama Purusha Tvanyaha. There is another Purusha who is Uttama. And this theme of Uttama Purusha, which if we turn it around, is Purushottama. This Purushottama will be described in the 15th chapter, which is called as Purushottam Yoga. So Uttama Purusha Tva Anyaha. There is another person who is a Purushottama. His name is Paramatmeti Udaharuta. He is called as Paramatma. Yo Lokatrayamavishya. He has entered into all the three worlds. Vibhartya Avyaya Ishvara. So this, the conditioned soul has entered into the material world and is trapped in it. Whereas the supreme soul has entered into the material world and is sustaining the material world. Vibharti Avyaya Ishvara. He is Avyaya and he is Ishvara. He is imperishable and he is the controller. Now apart from this, there is Kshetra and Kshetragya. So the terms are similar. So Prakriti is generic material nature. All of material nature is called as Prakriti. Now all of us, we have control, some control over a small section of Prakriti, and that is our body. We don't have control over everyone, but each of us has some control over our body. So the part of Prakriti over which, if Prakriti is this meta set, and the part of Prakriti on which we have control, that is called Kshetra. So Kshetra is, all of us will have different degrees of control over different magnitudes of Kshetra. Now ant has its Kshetra is extremely small. An elephant Kshetra is much larger. Now Kshetra is not to be measured only in terms of physical magnitude. It's also in terms of ability. Now there may be some famous singer, that person also has a throat like us, but that throat is not like us. Isn't it? Physically it is the same, but the extent of control that person has over the Kshetra and the kind of musical sound that the person is able to produce is entirely different. So the extent to which a Kshetra, a Purusha, has control over Kshetra, that is determined by one's karma. So different souls, depending on their karma from previous lives, they have different magnitudes of control. That's why some people can sing fluently, some people can speak fluently, some people, everybody has a material body, but some people have a very good looking material body, some people have average looks. So all these variations are there based on our past karma. So there is Kshetra and there is Kshetragya. Kshetragya is the knower of the Kshetra. And Krishna also, there are two kinds of Kshetragya. One is the local Kshetragya and the other is the global Kshetragya. Local Kshetragya is the Atma, the global Kshetragya is the Paramatma. And then there is also the Purusha, Prakriti, Kshetra, Kshetragya and Jnana and Jnana. So the sections in the Bhagavad Gita, the 13th chapter is among the most complex chapters in the Gita. Not among, it is the most complex. So much of it is very Upanishadic. The Upanishads delight in presenting complex things in complex ways. Why? Because there are people, if you tell them something very simply, oh, Radha Krishna is the divine couple. Okay. Radha is the primordial cosmological feminine principle and Krishna is the primordial cosmological masculine principle. Wow. It's the same thing essentially. But some people need more intellectually stimulating presentation. So the jnanis are of that orientation. And the Upanishads present things in very complex ways. And in this section of the Bhagavad Gita, chapters 13 to 18, especially chapter 13, Krishna uses that Upanishadic methodology. He presents things as paradoxes. He says, for example, he says that super soul, first he says in 13.14, Sarve is a sarvatah pani padam tat sarvato akshishiro mukham sarvatah shruti malloke sarvamavrutya tishthati sarvatah pani padam tat. Everywhere are his hands and legs, everywhere are his ears, everywhere are his eyes, and in this way he is everywhere. And just after saying that everywhere is hands and legs, immediately next verse he says sarvendriya gunabhasam sarvendriya vivarjitam asaktam sarvabhrukchaiva nirgunam gonabhoktrucha. He says he is the source of all senses, sarvendriya guna abhasam. But then immediately, sarvendriya vivarjitam. He is without any sense at all. So just now Krishna said that he has everywhere are his hands and legs, and suddenly he is saying he has no hands and legs. What is going on over here? So this might seem like a contradiction, but it's not a contradiction. This is a paradox. Contradiction means two statements are opposite. Paradox means two statements appear to be opposite, but if we go deeper, we find a reconciliation which harmonizes both. So paradoxes are ways in which deeper truths are often conveyed. So when Krishna says everywhere are his hands and legs, he is talking about the super soul who is present in every heart and present in every atom. Annantara paramanasu chayantarastam, as the Brahma Samhita says. But at the same time, the super soul does not have any, his form is not material, it is transcendental. So, the indriya, when Krishna uses the word, he uses it in the sense of material senses. The super soul does not have any material senses. So, these are paradoxes which are there. So, here, this section from 13.8 to 12 talks about jnana and 13.13 to 18 talks about jnana. So, jnanam jnayam jnanagamyam hridi sarvasya vishthitam. So, he said that supreme being is jnana, is jnaya and is jnanagamya. So what is this jnana, jnaya, jnana, gamya? I'm just giving a little glimpse of the technicality of the 13th chapter. I'll just finish this and we'll go on to more easier things. But what is Krishna telling? We can just get a glimpse of the profundity of the Gita over here. There is knowledge, there is the object of knowledge, and there is the objective of knowledge. These three are different things. Say for example, if a student is studying. So the student is acquiring knowledge. Then there is the object of knowledge. Okay, what are you acquiring knowledge about? Some students may say, I'm studying MBBS, I'm studying engineering, somebody else may study, I'm studying arts, whatever. So there is knowledge, what we are acquiring. There is the object of knowledge. Here the word object is, you can say, in terms of what are you studying. But there is the objective of knowledge. Objective of knowledge means, now why are you studying? It is not that most students, when they study, it's not that they are in love with biology or chemistry or mathematics. They are interested in their career, in their job, in the money that they will earn after that. So the jnana gamya, the objective of knowledge for them is not the particular subject. It is the money that they will earn from that. But in the transcendental process, in the transcendental realm, the jnana, the jnaya and the jnana gamya, all three are the same. The knowledge that we acquire is non-different from Krishna. Krishna says that those who, in the 18th chapter, he will tell later, we'll come to it. that those who study this, they are worshipping me with their intelligence. So this knowledge is actually Krishna himself. And the words of the Bhagavad Gita are non-different from Krishna. And by studying the Gita, what do we come to know? We come to know Krishna. So jnanam geyam jnanagamyam hridi sarvasya vishtitam. We are situated in the heart. That supreme being is situated in the heart. And the 13th chapter ends with a compound word which will come again in the 15th chapter and which is vital for understanding the worldview of the Bhagavad Gita. It last verse of the 13th chapter, 35th verse. Kshetra kshetra gyayon revam antaram jnana chakshusha bhuta prakriti moksham cha ye vidur yanti te param. So he says, Kshetra kshetra gyayon revam. Kshetra and Kshetra gya. Antaram jnana chakshusha. Understand the antara, the difference between the two. The word antara at one level means distance. At another level, it means difference. Now, when we understand the distance between matter, when we understand the difference between matter and spirit, we'll also understand the distance between them. Right now, we think of ourselves to be the body. So, kshetra kshetragyayorevam antaram jnana chakshusha. With the eyes of knowledge, understand this. Normally, we may say, what is this? Some people say, can you show me God? Can you show me soul? Actually, some people say, seeing is believing. If you show me, then I'll believe you. Actually, the truth is, if you believe it, then you will see it. Why is that? Because in any subject we go forward, if somebody is working in the stock market, and then you see a graph suddenly going downwards, and some stockbroker gets a heart attack on seeing the graph going downwards. Say, what happened? You know, just the line went downward. Why do you have to get a heart attack? So there is a jnana chakshu over there. Isn't it? What that graph going downwards means, a person who has knowledge that can understand that. You know, if somebody does a chest x-ray and the doctor sees the x-ray and doctor is alarmed. And the patient says, hey, what's the problem? Doctor says, you have got advanced TB. Now, how are we seeing that? It's jnana chakshu. So we actually don't see with our eyes. We see with the knowledge that we have that enables us to transform vision into comprehension. Vision is what we see, comprehension is what we understand. So it is education that transforms vision into comprehension. If there were no education, then vision might be there, visual data will go into our eyes, but there will be no comprehension. So it is education that is required. In biology or in medicine, there are two kinds of blindness. There is congenital blindness and there is adventitious blindness. So congenital is when a person is born blind. Adventitious is when that person becomes blind because of some accident or something like that. Now, through the advances of medical technology, in some cases, both kinds of blind people, their vision can be restored. Now, suppose I have seen videos of this also. So what happens is, if a person who has never had vision, that person is a carpenter. You know, even those without eyes can learn certain skills. And person is using maybe an axe or a knife or a hammer. And person's eyes are restored. And then that person looks at the axe, looks at the knife, and just nothing makes sense. So one person who was congenital blind, he said that I opened my eyes and then somebody spoke to me and all. I looked in that direction. And all that I could see was just a confusing array of bright and dark patterns. But because I knew that voices came from faces, I thought this must be the face of a person. So this same person was a carpenter. When this person, he saw the axe, he saw his own hammer, he couldn't understand it. What is this? And then he moved his hand and touched it immediately. Oh, this is the axe. He started using it. So, in this case, what has happened is, there is no background knowledge to transform the vision into comprehension. So, even when vision is there, but if there is no education, there is no comprehension. So, the Bhagavad Gita says that if you want to understand the Kshetra and Kshetrajna, we need Jnana Chakshusha. We need the eyes of knowledge to understand. And the Gita provides us this eyes of knowledge. Now in the 13th chapter, Krishna talked about 13.22 as Karanam Gunasangosya, because of association with the modes. The modes are referred to in the Gita repeatedly. Right from the second chapter itself, Krishna talks about the modes, and those references become more and more as the Gita progresses. In the 14th chapter, Krishna devotes entirely to the three modes. So, there is no question that Arjuna asks at the start of the 14th chapter, but Krishna himself is elaborating. So, when he's talking about Purusha, Prakriti, Kshetra, Kshetrajna, Jnana, Jnaya, now to understand Prakriti, the modes, the gunas are important. Now, what exactly are the modes? You know, the modes may not be familiar to us, but our moods are familiar to us. Now, we all have different moods at different times. And why we have different moods, it's sometimes very difficult to know. Just suppose three people are sitting in a bus and they are going along. So all of them are sitting on the window seats in three successive rows. And they look out of the window and they see a lush green forest. Now the first person is reading a book and the bus is a little bumpy, so he's not able to read. And he looks out and he sees, oh, such a large, green, comfortable forest. I could sit and I could read this book and I lose myself in the wisdom of this book. The second person, sitting on the second chair, that person has been watching a movie, just recently. And when he sees the forest, he remembers some romantic dance and song from the movie. And he starts thinking, oh, you know, if I had someone with me, I would also enjoy over here. The third person is lethargic, wants to sleep, and the bus is bumping up and down. And the person looks out and sees the forest. Oh, such a comfortable place to sleep peacefully and forget everything. It's the same thing. Same thing, entirely different perceptions. What made it not the difference? It is their mentality. And what do we mean by mentality? There can be different ways of explaining it. The Bhagavad Gita talks about the modes. So, the same visual data is going in, but the response to it is differing. So the modes are basically, they are the subtle forces that shape the interaction between matter and consciousness. When material impressions come in, how does the consciousness respond to them? So modes are subtle forces that shape the interaction between matter and consciousness. So the first person who was reading a book is in what we say sattvaguna, the mode of goodness. The second person who is thinking about romantic enjoyment, that person is in rajoguna, the mode of passion. The third person who is thinking of just dozing off, lazing off, that person is in the mode of ignorance, tamoguna. Now, the modes are not just shapers of consciousness. They are also constituents of nature. That means there are certain things which are in certain modes. So in that sense, the modes, we can say, if we going back to the earlier metaphor of a movie, essentially what we have is a screen. It may be LCD screen or whatever screen. And on that screen, all that happens is three colors. Light rays of three colors, they fall on that. But the light rays of those three colors, depending on how they are brought together, we have different shapes, patterns, motions. All these are formed because of originally only three colors. So like that, in 13.92, what Krishna says is, Purusha prakriti stohi bhungte prakriti jan gunan. What does one want to enjoy? One wants to enjoy the material things which are products of the three modes. So the objects that we see in this world, these objects are made of the three modes. And accordingly, we desire different things. So there is sattvaguna, which is sattva sanjayate jnanam rajaso lobha evacha pramada moha tamaso bhavato ajnanam evacha. Krishna says that Sattvat sanjayate jnanam. In sattva, knowledge arises. Rajaso lobha evacha. When there is rajoguna, there is lobha. There is greed. And pramada moha tamaso. And there is distraction, intoxication, illusion. Bhavato ajnana evacha. and then ultimately results in ignorance. That is, in the mode prabhada moho tavse bhavato ajnanam eva tamaso. This is the result of the mode of ignorance. So in the 14th chapter, Krishna gives characteristics of each of these modes. Now, when he gives characteristics of these three modes, the purpose is to provide us a map of our inner territory. To provide us a map of our inner territory. All of us have certain sattvic influences, certain rajasic influences, certain tamasic influences. And changing ourselves requires not just the desire to change oneself. The desire is important. But when we understand that the modes are the shapers of our desires, then we understand that actually what goes on in our inner world is not just a matter of our desire alone. Let me explain this further. What I mean by this, that most of you will probably be familiar with computers, or most, at least some smartphone or some computer-related device. So now, in any computer-related device, there are some things which are default patterns. So for example, if I'm going to surf the net, and if I have Google Chrome as my default browser, so as soon as I click a link, I don't have to choose Chrome. Automatically it gets chosen. That choice can be changed. I may choose Safari or I may choose Firefox, I may choose some other browser. But if I have set something as a default, it will automatically get chosen. I have to make conscious effort to change it. So the modes comprise our programming. Now all of us, when we say that we have a certain mode, that means that becomes our default choice. Now we can change the default choice, but the default choice is what is chosen automatically. And changing the default choice requires conscious effort. You know, I am a writer, so after I write my articles, I often have to proofread those articles. I have a text-to-speech software which reads it out. And then in the text-to-speech software, they correct some things. You know, if somebody has written T-E-H, they'll correct it to T-H-E so that it's read properly. So now I read once an article. So the soul is Satchitananda. So when this software was reading it, the soul is Saturday Chitananda. So it corrected Sat to Saturday. Now in English, S-A-T is a short form for Saturday. But I was writing in Sanskrit. Sat Chit Anand. So here what has happened is, the autocorrect is incorrect. So I had written Sat Chit Anand properly, but when it comes out of the program, it comes as Saturday Chit Anand. Anybody who reads it, what is going on? What are you doing with Saturday Chit Anand over here? So what is happening, even if I give in the right input, because that is the default program over there, so although my input is correct, the output comes out incorrect. So like that, we will see that sometimes we start doing an activity with a very sincere desire. We sit down to chant and now I am going to be attentive. I sit down and I want to be attentive, focus on Krishna. Maybe 10 mantras, 15 mantras, 20 mantras. And you know, he spoke that to me, she did like that, and I will do like this. And then, you know, there is a Kurukshetra going on in our head after some time. Now what happened? Now we went in with the right intention, but the mind has a certain default momentum. And that default momentum causes the mind to go here and there. So the default can be corrected, but it requires conscious effort. So the modes determine our default behavioral patterns. So like I said, there is a video game, going back to that example of a video game. In the video game, the player can change. Okay, if a person is flying a plane, okay, if an anti-aircraft missile comes along, you should swerve towards the left. That might be the default choice. You might be able to change it and move towards the right to avoid it. That can be done. But there will be certain default choices. So the modes determine our default choices. So depending on the mode which we are in, we will respond to situations in particular ways. And changing our responses is possible. But it requires not just the desire to change. It requires constant conscientious observation. Now we are, okay, this is what I went in to do this, and now suddenly things have gone off in the wrong direction. I have to bring it back. Now they say when a plane is flying, say for example, if I'm going from Mumbai to Calcutta to go to Mayapur, 90% of the time the plane is off track. You wonder that how does the plane reach the destination? Actually, it is off track because when it is going in the environment, there is the wind pressure, there are the clouds, there are atmospheric conditions. So the plane cannot move in a constant, absolute straight line. But the pilot and the autopilot mechanism that is in the plane, if the course is given, then the plane continuously does course correction. And by that course correction, the plane gets to the right destination. So there is continuous course correction that is required. So like that, same way, the modes are shapers of our thought patterns. And subsequently, after our thought patterns, our behavioral patterns. So what we need to do is continuous course correction. We shouldn't get discouraged if, say, when we start chanting and the mind starts wandering. Or we come to a temple, we want to have pure thoughts and suddenly some other undesirable thoughts start coming. There is no need to get discouraged. What we need to do is just correct ourselves. The mind may stray away, we don't have to let it stay away. The mind will stray away, but that doesn't mean that we have to let it stay away, we can bring it back. So gradually, in the lower modes, the mind will go to various superficial peripheral things. No, gradually, this is what will normally happen, but gradually as we become purified by the practice of bhakti, the mind will start coming towards goodness and it will start relishing higher spiritual things. And Krishna says in 14.11, Sarva dvareshu dehesmin prakasham upajayate jnanam yadatada vidyad vivruddham sattvam ityuta. So he says when the mode of goodness is prominent, what happens at that time? Sarva dvareshu dehesmin. One of the favorite Upanishadic metaphors is to compare the body to a city. We know that one of the metaphors is the body is compared to a chariot. The idea is to create a distance. Okay, you are different from your chariot. Like that, now we are in Mumbai, but we are different from Mumbai. So the body, now if say in Mumbai, there may be 5 railway tracks from which people come from different places. So like that, this body is a city in which there are 9 gates. So Krishna says over here, Sarva dvareshu dehesmin prakasham upajayate. So he says that all the gates in the city of the body, they are illumined with knowledge. When one is in goodness. Now what does it mean? Is it that if a person is in goodness, the eyes will become effulgent, the ears will become battery sources? No, that's not what he means. Here the Bhagavad Gita is a poetry. And one of the features of poetry is the use of poetic devices or literary ornaments, they are called. In Sanskrit, there are 2 alankars. One is Shabda Alankar and the other is Artha Alankar. Shabda Alankar means the same words are used with different meanings. For example, in the second chapter, Krishna says, Dehe Deha Bhritam Vara. So Dehe, he's talking about the body. Deha Bhritam. That is referring to the embodied soul. But the same word, Deha Deha, is used. Purusham Purusharshabha. So there are 2 words which sound the same, but the meanings are different. There's Artha Alankar also. So this is a literary ornament where when Krishna is using the doors to the senses are illumined by knowledge. What he means by that is, suppose a door is dark, the area of a door is dark, we will not know who is coming in, who is going out. So some thief may creep in and may destroy our property and plunder our property. We may not even come to know about it. But if the door is illumined, then we will be able to see who is coming in, and then we will decide whether to allow that person inside or not. So like that, when we are in goodness, we can the doors of our senses are opened, are illumined. That means we can understand, okay, what are the kind of sensory information that I should allow inside? What are the impressions that I need not allow inside? It's not that everything that the world is showing, we have to see it. You know, depending on what we allow inside, our insides are going to be shaped. So when we are in goodness, our doors are illumined. Okay, I should not see this. I should not hear this. I should not eat this. Why not? It is not that there is some external autocrat who is telling us, don't do this. Now there are, in today's world, there is this whole idea of freedom. Freedom is a very cherished conception, and that's natural. We all want to be free. But we often have a very limited conception of freedom. Now, freedom is not just the ability to do what we want to do. Freedom is also the ability to do what we should do. I'll explain this difference. Suppose a person is a recovering alcohol addict. Now there are people who get addicted, and it's not that every person who is an addict is a terrible person. Sometimes even people who are basically good, they get caught in a bad habit sometimes. Now this recovering alcohol addict wants, often there are treatment clinics, retreat centers sort of, where recovering alcoholics are told you go and stay there for 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, and intensive treatment. Now what happens? One of the fundamental things about any recovery center is that they don't have any access to alcohol. They don't have any access to alcohol. So here, this person who is alcoholic, he gives up the freedom to have access to alcohol. He voluntarily places himself in a situation where I'll not have alcohol. Why? He may say, it's your right, you can drink whatever you want. Why should you lose your freedom? The idea is he understands, at least if he's trying to recover, he has the intelligence to understand that this freedom to drink, I may exercise that freedom, but with each indulgence, Krishna will talk about this in the 16th chapter, he says, Asha Pasha Shatair Baddhaha. We become bound by our desires. So people may say, I am free, I can go wherever I want. Yes, we are free physically, but we are bound mentally. Now when an alcoholic is there, say if this is his home, this is his office, and in between there is a bar. So what happens? That alcoholic, now somebody who has never drunk alcohol, that person just goes by straight to the office. May not even notice there is a bar. But that person, maybe he has drunk once or twice, then what happens? As soon as he starts passing by the alcohol, immediately the mind goes into, maybe I should drink. No, I should not drink. I should drink. I should not drink. And if that person indulges again and again, then in period of time, he doesn't even have to see the bar. As soon as he comes out of his house, his mind has already gone into the bar. And so what has happened? There is an invisible rope that ties the mind to its object of attachment. And that rope drags us towards that object. So, freedom, when we say, we always think of freedom in terms of the ability to do what we want to do. But freedom can have also another dimension. Freedom also has a dimension of being able to refuse to do what we shouldn't be doing. The alcoholic understands, I shouldn't be drinking, but that alcoholic just doesn't have the freedom. The ropes that are dragging are so tight that one just drag towards it. So as long as we think of freedom only in terms of what we are free to do, what we are free for doing, we have a limited conception of freedom. Another dimension of freedom is, what are we free from doing? What we are free from doing. Today morning in his Bhagavatam class, Chandramouli Maharaj was talking about shopaholics. Shopaholism is actually a far greater addiction than alcoholism. They say there is a book on it, I read a book, it's called You Are What You Shop. So a shopper is his or her whole sense of self-identity comes from what I shop. So what happens over here is, actually that person has the freedom whether to buy or not to buy. But the person doesn't have the freedom. Because the desire has got so tight and has to purchase something. So now alcoholism may be an extreme example, we may say it's not relevant to us. Shopaholism is something which is more relevant to us. Now there is also what they call as foodaholism. Foodaholism means people are just addicted to eating. And now food is necessary for survival. But there is hunger and there is pseudo-hunger. Pseudo-hunger means that hunger comes not from the body, it comes from the mind. See, if I am using, I'll just quickly explain. I'm talking about the concept of how the modes bind us. Suppose I have got a car and I know I have filled 10 liters petrol. And 10 liters fuel, and the car's average is around
40 kilometers per liter or whatever. So if I fill 10 liters, it should go for 400 liters, 400 kilometers. But I suddenly find that after 4 liters, after going only 100 kilometers, the fuel tank is showing empty. Something is wrong. Either the tank is leaking or the fuel indicator itself is wrong. So like that, if I have eaten adequate food for breakfast, then I know that the body has enough fuel to run till lunch. But if after 2 hours, suddenly I start feeling hungry. If I have eaten enough and I have not overworked, then that sudden untimely hunger, it is not biological hunger, it is psychological hunger. So psychological hunger means it is the attachment to the food that is making me feel that I should eat it. It's like our there's a fuel tank indicator. If it malfunctions, there is already fuel, but we keep pouring in fuel in it. So like that, the body already has food in it, but because our hunger indicator malfunctions, so we put in more food in it. We put more food in it. This happens sometimes. So essentially, all this analysis, first of alcoholism, then of shopaholism, then of food addiction, all these examples I'm giving to say that we are all not necessarily free. We all have certain desires that bind us. And we need to, these desires, the things that bind us, they are determined by our modes. So when we come into mode of goodness, we can start observing. Oh, this is the kind of influences that are coming in. I should not let them in. These are influences that are coming, these are good for me. So freedom, bhakti, it may seem that, oh, you should not eat this, you should not go here, you should not do that. We may say, I'm losing my freedom. But by the spiritual practices, we don't lose our freedom, actually we gain our freedom. Just like a recovering alcoholic, he goes and stays in an alcohol treatment center for 1 month or 6 months, whatever. By that, by forcibly depriving oneself from source of alcohol, by voluntarily renouncing that freedom, one becomes free from that unhealthy desire. So like that, there are certain desires we have which are unhealthy, which are distracting, which are degrading, and we become free from those desires. And we become free to do what is good for us, what is beneficial for us. So I was talking about how the modes determine our default choices, and the process of bhakti enables us to change our default choices. So now, in the 14th chapter, Krishna says, till 20th verse, Krishna gives a description. In the 21st verse, Arjuna asks a question, which is similar to what he has asked in 2.54. He asks, what are the characteristics of a person who has transcended the modes? Kairlinga istringuna anetan atito bhavati prabho kimacharah katham chaitam stringunan ati vartate. He asks three questions. What are the characteristics internally of a person who has transcended the modes? What are the characteristics externally of a person who has transcended the modes? And how can I know, or how can I transcend the modes? So Krishna, when he talks about the next two verses, 22nd, 23 is the answer to the internal characteristics, 24, 25 is the answer to the external characteristics, and 26 is the process. So he says internal characteristic is not that there are no desires. He says there is temptation and there is transgression. Temptation means the desire to do something. Transgression is doing something wrong. So tolerance is the blocker between temptation and transgression. When we have the capacity to tolerate, somebody may speak in a way which makes me angry. So it's a temptation to shout and blast and maybe hit that person. But I don't have to actually do that if I have tolerance. So Krishna says the person who is moving towards transcendence, that person has that wall of tolerance internally, by which one's responses are not shaped by one's conditions. One's responses are shaped by one's principles. Our responses are shaped not by one's conditions, but by one's principles. A few months ago, I was in Melbourne. So one devotee asked a question there. He said that sometimes there are some devotees who don't like me. There's one devotee who doesn't like me. And I try to do some service with him or her, whatever. But always that devotee gives negative vibrations. So what should I do? And if that devotee is here, what would you like to tell that devotee? So now, I explained elaborately, but relevant to this topic is that Actually, if we consider, if our responses are determined only by our conditions, then that person is irritable, I'll become irritable. That person is short-tempered, I'll become short-tempered. That is, we stay at the same level of consciousness that they are. But suppose a person is a salesman in a shop of ready-made clothes. That person is standing at the counter and is showing different clothes. And there is the owner who is also sitting at the money counter and is observing the employees. Now there are some shoppers who are very, very finicky about certain things. They may see 100 clothes and not purchase even one cloth. They find faults with every cloth. So now the salesperson at that place may get irritated. You are looking at so many, not choosing any. But if the salesperson sees, understands, you know, my salary is not coming from this person. My salary is coming from the owner. And the owner is observing. If the owner sees that I still stay courteous and polite, even when people are irritating, the owner will observe that. The owner will appreciate that. And the owner will eventually reward me for it. So similarly, when we are interacting with people, if we as devotees let our interaction stay only two-dimensional, you know, as you behave, tit for tat. If we have only that level of consciousness, then where are we conscious of Krishna? Now we understand that whatever is happening, yes, this person is behaving in an irritating way, but Krishna is watching. And my response is to please Krishna. Yes, I want to serve this person, I want to have a relationship with person, this person also, but I am having a relationship with this person not just for the sake of this person. I am having it for the sake of Krishna. So our responses are shaped not just by our conditions, but by our principles. And then the conditions may be provocative. Now it is not that we can never get provoked. In certain situations, it may be required to speak strongly, but that is a decision. It is not a default response. A decision means what I think, deliberate and decide. Okay, this is the time when I need to speak strongly. But a default response is just somebody is applying pressure and like suddenly a pressure cooker bursts. So like that we burst. That is unregulated. So by the practice of bhakti, as we situate ourselves in the higher modes, our responses become not a function of our conditions, but they become functions of our principles. Now in the 15th chapter, this was the 14th chapter, which is about, so Krishna concludes the 14th chapter by saying that the way one can go beyond the modes is by practicing bhakti. Mamchayo vibhicharena bhakti yogena sevate sagunan samatityaitan brahma bhuyaya kalpate. So avyabhichari bhakti, just practice bhakti unbreakably. Now there is a difference between uninterrupted devotional service and unmotivated devotional service. In the condition stage, our devotional service cannot be unmotivated. Now we have even the motive of purification is also motive. But still, it can be uninterrupted. Uninterrupted means, even if I don't feel like practicing bhakti, still I'll practice. Why? Because I know it will purify me. I know it will please Krishna. So, Krishna doesn't just see our feelings. Krishna also sees our feelings about our feelings. That means, our feelings about our feelings means, sometimes, you know, we are reading books, so we are hearing class and we just feel bored. Now, that feeling of boredom may just come in our consciousness. How do we respond to it? We just look a dozen times in a minute at our clock to see when the class is going to get over. Or we try to fight off that boredom. Krishna, I want to be interested. So, there are certain feelings which will come as default responses because of the modes. But what is our feeling about those feelings? If we try to resist those feelings, Krishna sees that, Krishna appreciates that. And we move onwards because of that endeavor, that inner endeavor to try to cultivate the right feelings. So avyabhichari bhakti doesn't have to be unmotivated, but it should be uninterrupted. Every day we keep chanting, every day we keep practicing bhakti, whatever is our capacity. Now in the 15th chapter, Krishna himself moves onwards without any question. So here he starts with the metaphor of an upside down banyan tree. Urdhva moola madhaya shakham ashvattham prahuravyayam chandam siyasya paranani yastam vedasa vedavet. Says there is an upside down tree. Urdhvamulam adhashakam. The roots are upwards and the branches are downwards. And the acharyas explain that this refers to a reflection. So this world, Krishna says, is like a reflection of reality. So the nature of illusion. Now earlier I gave an example of, say, this world is like a virtual reality. And that is, actually, it's an example which conveys one dimension of reality. But no example conveys the whole material reality fully. Prabhupada once gave a lecture that the whole material world is an illusion. And then one of his early disciples, he said, he was just walking out of the temple. And he saw the whole material world is an illusion. Maybe this wall is also an illusion. So if I think that the wall is an illusion I try to walk through the wall, will I be able to walk through the wall? This wall is an illusion, this wall is an illusion, this wall is an illusion. And bam! Hit his head against the wall. So he said, Prabhupada, you said that the whole world is an illusion. Prabhupada said, yes, the whole world is illusion means what? You have to understand. That what is illusion is not the world itself. It is the world's promise that we can become happy over here. This world, this exists over here. Now, the table exists, my body exists, your body exists. And the promise, what is the illusion is the promise that by making certain arrangements in this world, we will become happy. The world itself is real. So Krishna, so sometimes we may say that this world is like a dream. Yes, it's like a dream in one sense. But there is also, it doesn't mean that the whole world has to be rejected. There is a process that has to be followed to come out of the dream, to wake. So that similarly, Krishna uses different metaphor over here. So he uses the word metaphor of a reflection in the 15th chapter. And in this chapter, the acharyas explain that, Shankaracharya also says this in his Narasimha Karavalamba Sotra. He says, samsara sarpa vrikshadvi, samsara vriksha agabijam ananta karma, shakhayutam karnapatram ananga pushpam, aruya dukkha falilam patitam dayalo, lakshmi narasimha mama dehi karavalambam. So he says, samsara vriksha, this world is like a vriksha. And agha bijam, agha is desire, from a sinful desire. So it's desire, just as a tree comes from a seed, similarly this whole material existence comes from agha bija. And that agha bija is talked about in 13.22, that's why I said 13.22 is the bija vakya, purusha prakriti stohi bhunte prakriti jan gunan. So in Krishna talks about the modes of material nature, he says, the link between the 14th and 15th chapters is that, Krishna says the modes are the water that nourish this tree. A tree exists, how does a tree grow? When it is watered. So he says, the nourisher of this tree is the modes. And then, this tree itself cannot be destroyed, but our entanglement in the tree can be destroyed. Asanga shastrena drudhena chitva. With detachment, you cut yourself off. And then, what is there beyond this world? Krishna tells that there is my abode. Natad bhasayate suryo na shashanko na pavakaha. That there is no light, that in that abode there is not illumined by the sun, by the moon, by fire. So here Srila Prabhupada adds in his purport, in his translation itself, he says there is no electricity over there. Now we wonder, where is it? There is no electricity. Na pavakaha. Pavakaha is fire. So how is Prabhupada adding electricity over here? See, when scripture is to be taught, the point is not to get it right. The point is to get it across. The point is not to get it right. The point is to get it across. Scripture has to be presented in a way that is relevant to people. So the essential point of this verse in the 15th chapter is that in the spiritual world, everything is luminous. It's self-luminous. There is no need for external luminosity. And Krishna talks about the same thing in the with respect to the material world in 15.12. This is 15.6. In 15.12, he says the same three items, the sun, moon and fire. He says, yadaditya gatam tejo jagat bhasete akhilam yachandramasi chagnam tat tejo vidhimamakam. So he says, this world is illuminated by the sun, the moon and fire. And they come, their effulgence comes from me. So the essential point of this verse is that the material world needs sources of illumination, whereas the spiritual world does not need any source of illumination. Now, Prabhupada's readers, people in the modern and the postmodern world, they mostly live where the primary source of illumination that they experience is electricity. Now we, We know that theoretically we know the sun is what gives light, but we often live in an artificially illuminated environment. So when Prabhupada is adding electricity over here, what is he doing? He is explaining the relevance of the verse. The essential point of the verse is that we don't need any artificial source of illumination. It is self-luminous. So there is the there is a literal translation and there is a essential translation. Essential translation means which conveys the essential meaning. So there's a computer program which tried to do translation. This is of course apocryphal, but it illustrates the point which is there, that there is this biblical saying, the flesh is willing but the spirit is weak. What it means is that the spirit is willing but the flesh is weak. What it means is that we have a desire for doing nobler things but our body drags us down. So they had a computer program which translated this into Russian and it retranslated that into English. So what happened? The spirit is willing but the flesh is weak. So that got translated into Russian and when it got retranslated into English, it became the vodka is good but the meat is spoiled. The spirit is willing. They thought spirit means alcohol. Alcohol is vodka. So the vodka is good, but the flesh is weak. The meat is spoiled. So if we just go into literal translations, what happens is we can lose the meaning completely. So Prabhupada doesn't focus on literal translations. He gives us essential meanings. So in the 15th chapter, Krishna talks about how that same point which I mentioned, 13.35, is jnana chakshu. He talks about it again in this 15th chapter, 15.11. He says that how shariram yadavapnoti yachapyut kramatishvara grihitvaitani sanyati vayur gandhani vashayat. So he says that how the soul resides in the body, how the soul moves from one body to another, how the soul is controlled by the modes, all this the fools cannot see. We have to see with the eyes of knowledge. And these eyes of knowledge, he gives us first with respect to the material world, when he says how even when we are living in this world, we depend on God all the time. Many people think that science, as it has advanced, now science can provide all the answers to us. And therefore, science can solve all our problems. We don't need God. Actually, yes, science can offer us many things. But science operates based on certain laws. And those laws are not made by science. Those laws are not made by nature. It's an enduring mystery in science. Where do laws come from? So actually, as Indian mathematician Srinivasa Ramanuja said, that an equation for me has no meaning unless it represents a thought of God. So the more we study science and the more science is able to do things, a spiritually informed person sees in every advance of technology not just the intelligence of man, but also the intelligence of God. So yes, we humans have manipulated nature using technology, but that capacity for manipulability, the principle that nature operates according to law, that comes from God. So Krishna talks about various ways in which he sustains material existence from 15.12 to 15.14. And then he says, how I am present in the heart and I give knowledge. Mattah smritir jnanam apohanam cha. Then he describes how he is the ultimate goal of all the Vedas. And then he concludes that chapter by saying that one who understands him, yomameva sammudo janati purushottama sa sarvavid bhajati mam sarva bhavena bharata. That one who understands him to be the absolute truth, that person is truly enlightened. So the 13.22 was the seed of the tree of material existence. Then 15th chapter described the tree itself. The 16th chapter describes the uppermost and the lowermost part of the tree. And the 17th chapter describes the middle part of the tree. So what does this mean? That if there is a, going back to the earlier metaphor of the movie. In a movie, there are certain things which will make us happy, certain things which will make us horrified, certain things which will make us miserable. So there are whole different kinds of emotions that come. So like that, within this material existence, there are different impressions that we have, different kinds of behaviors that we do, and different kinds of reactions that we get. So the two extremes, that is Daiva Asura Sampad Vibhaga Yoga. The 16th chapter describes the divine nature and the demoniac nature. So the divine nature, now Krishna describes a list of qualities, and the important thing is Abhijato Si Pandava. Abhijatosi Pandava means we are born with these qualities. So all of us have certain sets of qualities which we just are born with. Now, why we are born with certain qualities? There is reductionistic science which tries to say that everything about us comes from our genes. Now, genes are important. They do shape maybe the pigment of our skin, the particular structure of our bones, certain things they shape. But they don't shape everything. How is that? First of all, how can genes determine the mood of a person, the personality of a person? There is no scientific explanation for that. And even within the realm of scientific explainability, there is something which is called as monozygotic twins. Monozygotic twins means there are two twins, so the same zygote, the same egg splits into two, and then two twins are born. So now in this case, their whole genetic substance is entirely identical. The twins are usually genetically similar. But in the case of monozygotic twins, they are genetically identical. And though they are genetically identical, they are not behaviorally identical. They are individuals in their own right. They have their own moods, their own personalities, their own behaviors. So where does this behavior come from? It is not coming from their upbringing, because both of them had the same parents, same upbringing, but still they are different. So our behaviors are not just shaped by our genes. There are certain qualities which the soul is pure, but around the soul there is a subtle body. And in the subtle body, certain impressions are stored. And those impressions are expressed through the gross body. So, the Bhagavad Gita's 16th chapter tells that there are certain qualities which are divine, certain qualities which are demoniac. But, you know, our impressions go with us, but they don't have to grow with us. They go with us from this body to the next body. They have come with us from our previous body to this body. So, some of us may have certain godly qualities, certain ungodly qualities. But we are not slaves of those qualities. We can change those qualities. And the whole 16th chapter describes, first three verses describe the Daivi Sampad. Then the next, almost 20 verses, 17 verses describe the Asuri Sampad, the demoniac nature. And if you see the demoniac nature when it describes, Asau maya hatah shatrur hanishye chapara anapi ishvaroham ambhogi siddhoham balvan sukhi. He says, idamasti idamapi bhavishyati punardhanam. He says, this much wealth I have acquired. This much more wealth I'll acquire. You know, this enemy I have eliminated. That enemy I'll eliminate next. So the way Krishna describes it, we can say that Krishna was probably thinking of Duryodhana at that time. Duryodhana had this mentality. I got this much kingdom and I'll get this much. And there are many people who have this mentality. So Krishna, after he describes this, he says that such, now he's, Krishna gives many subtle nuances also. He doesn't say these people are necessarily atheistic. He says, Atma Sambhavita Stabda Dhanaman Madanvitaha Yajante Nama Yajnaiste Dambhena Vidipurvakam. He says they are self-complacent and impudent. And Yajante Nama Yajnaiste. They don't do Nama Yajna. They don't chant the names. They do Yajna for Nam. They do sacrifice so that they can become famous. They give charity. They do various things so that they can become very, very famous. You know, if there is some festival, they want that, okay, if there is some temple, my temple should be biggest in the whole world. Or if I am going to do something religious, I do it so that I get fame. So they may be religious, but their purpose of religion is not purification. It is simply self-glorification. And then Krishna says that there are these demoniac qualities, ungodly qualities can be condensed into three. And they are lust, anger, greed. These are three gates to hell. Trividham narkasya idam dwaram nashanam atmanaha. These destroy the soul. Now Krishna has said in 2.17, avinashitu tadviddhi. The soul cannot be destroyed. But here in 16.21 he is saying, dwaram nashanam atmanaha. These three destroy the soul. So this destruction is not literal, it's metaphorical. That the soul's spiritual awareness is destroyed by ungodly activities, by demoniac activities. So then the 16th chapter concludes with a call that Arjuna, you should follow Shastra and you will stay purer. If you don't follow Shastra, tasmat shastram pramanam te karya karya vyavasthito. Know what is to be done and what is not to be done from Shastra. What is the meaning of following Shastra? It essentially means that when we follow Shastra, we don't become bound by our conditionings. Rather, we become freed from our conditionings. The default behavioral patterns that we have got, we are not forced to act according to them. We can change and cultivate healthy thought patterns and healthy behavioral patterns. Now, at the start of the 17th chapter, Arjuna asks a question about the middle. He says, okay, top is those who are godly, bottom are those who are demoniac. So the godly accept Shastra and live according to Shastra. The ungodly reject Shastra and live according to their self-centered desire. But what about those who are in between? Yah Shastra vidhim utsrujya vartate shraddhayanvita tesham nishtha tuka krishna sattvam rajastama iti tamaha. So he asks that those who do not accept Shastra but they have some faith, what is their situation? So here we can see the analytical framework that the Bhagavad Gita offers, we can use it to analyze the current world scenario. Now today we have various religions, say. We have Hinduism, we have Christianity, we have Islam. And these religions, what is the Gita's perspective on them? Now we don't see any direct reference to Islam or Christianity in the Gita. What to speak of that? We don't see any direct reference to Hinduism in the Gita. But what is the Gita's frame? So Gita gives us objective criteria. It's behavioral patterns. You know, what is their conception of charity? What is their conception of food? What is their conception of behavior? What is their conception of austerity? So Gita gives behavioral characteristics by which we can infer the moods. So now, because of the fear of terrorism, it is true that there is a great threat because of terrorism. But say in America, there is one American presidential candidate who is saying, let us ban all Muslims. Now this sort of mentality, ban all Muslims from immigrating to America. What this does is, it lumps everyone into one category. There's all Muslims, they're potential terrorists, so let us ban all of them. But the Bhagavad Gita offers us a characteristic analysis based not on some ideal, some religious affiliation, but on behavioral characterization. It says that there are, even among Muslims, even among Hindus, even among Christians, even among atheists, there are people who are in goodness, there are people who are in passion, there are people who are in ignorance. And people who are in ignorance, they will cause violence and they will justify their violence by whatever they want. If we see Hitler's Nazi Germany, that was at that time in the 1940s and 1940s, it was at the pinnacle of scientific progress. And they had developed a lot of weapons and they were driven towards scientific progress, and they were using scientific progress to scientifically slaughter the Jews. The gas chambers, they were not like traditional guillotines or methods of execution, they were scientific things. So the point is, Hitler was primarily, he was nominally Christian, but he was primarily motivated by atheism. And there they use science to kill people. Now even if we want to argue that way, that even if there are terrorists and terrorists are killing people, we could say that terrorists are able to kill so many people because there are weapons of mass destruction. And the weapons of mass destruction, if there were no bombs, if there were no high-tech weapons, then if terrorists want to kill, how many people would they have been able to kill? So the point I'm making is that somebody wants to blame, they can blame technology. Because technology is there, that's why terrorists are able to kill so many people. So this sort of blaming peripheral things, whether it is technology or whether it is religion, it neglects the reality that people are functions of their own psychology. So technology can be used for good purposes, technology can be used for bad purposes. Similarly, religious belief can be used for good purposes, religious belief can be used for bad purposes. So the Bhagavad Gita says, rather than lumping everybody in one category, we have to see goodness, passion and ignorance. And when I wrote this book, GK for PK, answering the questions over there about the movie PK. So there I wrote in the introduction, I have an online Muslim friend and he told me that it is easier for me to communicate with moderates of other traditions than with extremists of my own tradition. So moderates of other traditions means there may be Muslim who is a Sattvaguna, there is a Christian in Sattvaguna, there is a Hindu in Sattvaguna. But they can think alike and they can have better communication than a Muslim in Sattvaguna and a Muslim in Tamoguna. Or what to speak of Muslim, when Hindus in Sattvaguna and Hindus in Tamoguna, it will be difficult to communicate. So the simplistic reduction of a whole category as bad. Now that oversees the reality that people are not all in one homogeneous behavioral category. Even if people belong to a particular religion, they will be different depending on their psychology. And that is shaped by the modes. Now, after giving this analysis, Krishna moves into the 18th chapter. And the 18th chapter, Arjuna, it's the summary of all the six chapter of the previous chapter. So Arjuna asks the same question which he has asked right at the beginning. He asks, what should we do? Can you explain what is Tyaga and what is Vairagya? Tattva Michchami Veditum. He says, I want to understand the Tattva of what is Tyaga and what is Sannyasa. So essentially the question is, Arjuna is asking, should I fight or should I not fight? So Krishna explains that sannyasa is physical renunciation, tyaga is emotional non-involvement. So everybody doesn't have to be physically renounced, but we have to become emotionally non-involved, emotionally detached. And working with emotional detachment, we can all become purified. So Krishna answers that question briefly, and then he analyzes in terms of Sankhya, the modes, the ways in which we act. And he says that, actually speaking, there are, this is a little technical, I'll quickly explain this and I'll go to the conclusion. He said there are five factors when we act. Adhishthanam tatha karta karanam chi pratakvida vividhashiputak cheshta daivam chaivatra panchamu. There are five factors in every action. For example, right now I am speaking. I may say, I am speaking. You know, what else is there? Who else is doing anything? But the fact is, Krishna says there are five factors. So, is adhishtha, that is the field of action, that is the body. Karta is the soul. Adhishthana tatha karta karanam cha prithak vidha. There are the various senses through which the action takes place. Vividhascha prithak cheshta. And there are different endeavors. And then, daivam chaivatra panchamam. Daiva is the divine will. The Supreme's will manifested through the actions of the devatas, administering devatas. So to give an example of this, suppose a cricketer is batting. And the cricketer is batting, and the bowler bowls, and the cricketer swings the bat, and the ball goes for a sixer. So the batsman hit a brilliant sixer. The next time the bowler bowls the same ball, the batsman swings the bat the same way, but he misses the line and is clean bowled. Now what happened? The same batsman, similar ball, similar shot, but completely different result. But the sixer, the other was a clean bowl. So what happens? It is, there are in cricket, sometimes they say the batsman is out of form. Now no batsman wants to be out of form. Why do they go out of form? No matter how brilliant a batsman may be, the batsman is not the supreme controller. So what happens? There is the field. The batsman may be a very skilled batsman, but if that person has got some injury, now God says some stomach upset, and the batsman cannot come on the field itself. So the first of all, the body has to be functional, adhishthanam. Then the soul, the karta. There is a person who is playing cricket. If that person is dead, that dead body comes on the cricket field, nothing can happen. Karanam cha prithak vidha. And there are specific senses. So if a person is batting, then there are various fields. The person has to have sharp vision. There is hand-leg motion coordination. There's proper stance, proper moving of the bat. All this is the training of the senses. Karanam, so the body itself has to be fit, but also the specific senses have to be competent to do the action. Then vividhascha prithak cheshta. Then after that, it's not that a batsman is born a champion the day he's born. They also have to practice. So that is cheshta. So whatever we are doing, by endeavor, we improve. Arjuna was a great archer, but even he endeavored, he practiced tirelessly. And then daivam chaivatra panchamam. Ultimately, destiny is the deciding factor. There are many cricketers who have their own superstitions. There's a famous cricketer, Australian captain. He would always keep a red handkerchief in his pocket. You know, maybe 1/4 of it out, 3/4 of it inside. And he thought that was a good luck charm. Sometimes he would drop a catch. First, he would, after dropping the catch, instead of taking the ball, he would look, have I dropped the handkerchief? How do I drop the catch? So now cricketers know that I have to perform. But they also know that performance matters, but performance is not all that matters. That despite the best performance, sometimes things can just go out of control. And there are forces bigger than human performance that shape the results. and they in their own way try to appease that performance. There was an Australian batsman, whenever he would go out to bat, first he would go to the pavilion commodes and make sure all the lids were closed. And if he would get out early, first he would go to see if any commode lid is open. And if any lid would be open, he would go and blast his team members. Why did you keep it open? Now what has that person's batting got to do with the commode lid being open or closed? It's a superstition. But the point is, they all know that apart from their performance, there is something else that also shapes the results. And they are in their own way trying to appease that. So, daiva, there is a destiny which also shapes our results. And Krishna says that if we act with detachment, then tatraivam sati kartaram atmanam kevalantu yapashyatya kritabuddhitvan nasapashyati durmatihi. If we act with detachment, then we will not become bound. Only one who thinks that I am the doer, not just I am the doer, I am the sole doer. That person is an illusion, that person gets bound. And after that, after analyzing various things within the three modes further, the same analysis which Krishna gave in the 14th chapter, he gives in the 17th chapter, he continues in the 18th chapter. So he talks about karma, karta, buddhi, jnana and dhriti in the three modes. And then he talks about sukha in the three modes. And then he talks about varnashram as a means for gradual elevation beyond the modes. And then in 18.56 is, so Krishna has, in one sense from the 13th chapter, it is a path of jnana. So it's a gradual ladder that is going up. And 18.56 Krishna says that by the process of bhakti, bhaktya mam vijanati yavanyaschasmi tattvata tatomam tattvato gyatva vishati tanantaram. That by the practice of bhakti, one will attain liberation. This is 18.55. Now from here, by talking about this gradual process of purification through jnana to the culmination of bhakti, then Krishna says in 18.56, he drops down a ladder and he says, bhakti can be, you don't have to go through the whole gradual process to come to the level of bhakti. You can practice your bhakti from anywhere. Sarva karmanya pisada kurvano madhvyapashraya. Sarva karmanya pisada. Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur in his commentary explains that whatever work you are doing, you can do your work, but do it in a mood of devotion. And by doing it in the mood of devotion, you will become liberated. Krishna says, Machitta sarva durgani mat prasada tarishyasi. If you become conscious of me, you will pass over all obstacles by my grace. Krishna is not saying obstacles will go away. You will pass over my all obstacles by my grace. Now when we face problems in life, all of us will face problems. But our perception of the problem often becomes a bigger problem than the problem. That means, suppose I have some problem. So that is like a 20 kg weight which I have to carry. If suddenly somebody says you have to carry 20 kg weight. It will be irritating. It will be exhausting. But suppose I have to carry 20 kg weight and I'm going to pay, I have to do it. But while that time I put 30 kg more on top of it. And I have to carry 50 kg. That will be impossible. So like that, life puts some problems in us, but when we become problem conscious, why did this happen? Why did things go like this? Why did it go like that? That resentment that we have, that saps our energy internally. So that problem is a 20 kg problem, but our resentment becomes like a 30 kg weight on top of that. And then we lose our ability to deal with the problem. So Krishna says, if you become conscious of me, machittaha. So when you become conscious of Krishna, we are no longer problem conscious. And then we understand, problem is there. Okay, I'll have to live with it. I'll have to deal with it. But if we are, if our thoughts are consumed by the problem, then the problem starts becoming bigger and bigger and bigger. And we start feeling our ability to deal with it smaller and smaller and smaller. And then we become overwhelmed. But if we are conscious of Krishna, then we can see the problem in perspective and deal with it properly. Krishna says that the problem will not go away, but you will be able to go over the problem. Mat prasada tarishyasi. And then, after this, Krishna tells that, yes, things are controlled by material nature, but I am in control of material nature. Therefore, if you surrender to me, you will transcend material nature. Tameva sharanam gacha sarva bhavena bharata. Surrender to him. And then, 18.63, Krishna tells Arjuna, now I have completed my message. He says, iti guhyatam, he says, vimrishaita desheshena yathechasita thaku. Now deliberate and decide what you want to do. The Bhagavad Gita is not a book of commandments. In the Bible, there are 10 commandments in the biblical tradition. the Old Testament, the Ten Commandments. The Bhagavad Gita is not so much a book of commandments as a book of choices. Choices and consequences. Krishna tells, if you do this, this will happen. If you do this, this will happen. Now you decide what you want to do. So Krishna tells, Vimrishchaita dasheshena. Deliberate deeply and decide what you want to do. Yathechasi tatha kuru. So the Bhagavad Gita offers us a vision of God who respects human independence and human intelligence. The God is not just saying, do this, don't do this. He's actually appealing to human intelligence. He is not telling Arjuna, I'm telling you so you do this. He answers Arjuna's questions in a very reasonable and intelligent way. So he appeals to his intelligence and he respects Arjuna's independence. You decide what you want to do. Yathechasi tatha kuru. And then Vishwanathachakra Thakur says, at this point, Arjuna goes into deep thought. I think Krishna said this in the second chapter, Krishna said this in the fourth chapter, this in the seventh chapter, this in the 12th chapter, this in the 18th chapter. What exactly should I be doing? And as Arjuna goes deep into thought, it becomes pensive. So Krishna's compassion overflows. And Krishna says, oh Arjuna, you don't have to get lost in this deep thought. I'll tell you what you should do. So he says, sarva guhyatamam bhuyaha shunu me paramam vachaha ishtosi me drudamiti tato vakshami te hitam sarva guhyatamam bhuyaha. Most confidential knowledge I'll give to you now. Shunu me paramam vachaha, the second superlative. First superlative is sarva guhyatamam, this is the most confidential. Second superlative is paramam vachaha, these are my supreme words. Ishtosi me drudamiti. Ishtosime, you are very dearly loved by me. You are strongly loved by me. Tato vakshamite hitam. Therefore, for your benefit, I am speaking this. So Krishna is telling Arjuna, don't be confused. I'll make things very clear to you. And then he says, manmana bhava mad bhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru mam evaishyasi satyam te pratijane priyosime. This 18.65 is almost identical to 9.34. Where also Krishna said the same thing. But in 9.34, the emphasis is Mam evaishyasi yuktvaivam atmanam matparayana. Manmanabha mat bhakta, that is the same. But he says, if you stay engaged in this way, you will come to me. So there in 9.34, the emphasis on what the soul has to do, what we have to do. But here the emphasis on Krishna is what I will do. Mam evaishyasi satyam te, you will surely come to me. This is the truth. Pratijane priyosime. You are, know that you are very dear to me. So earlier Krishna has told Arjuna, Kaunteya pratijanihi name bhaktaha pranashyati. You declare that my devotee will not perish. So Krishna is not satisfied with Arjuna declaring. Krishna is saying, I am declaring also. My devotees are very dear to me. And still, now what Krishna, you have given so many instructions. There are so many Vedas. So many different things are there in the scriptures. So what should we do? So he says, sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami mashuchah. Just give up everything else and surrender to me alone. This is all that you need to do. Mamekam sharanam vraja. Alone, me alone you surrender. What will happen by that? Aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami. I will free you from all sins. Now in 7.28, Krishna has told Arjuna that you first become free from sins, then you will become fixed in bhakti. Yesham tvantagatam papam jananam punya karmanam te dvandva moha nirmukta bhajante mam dudavrataha. That after you become purified from sins, then you will become fixed in bhakti. But here Krishna is saying, don't bother about it, just start practicing bhakti, I will purify you of all sins. So the acharyas give the example that, now say, there's a small baby that is growing up, and the mother is offering potty training to the baby. You have to respond to nature, you should go to the washroom. And that baby soils his clothes. The mother gets angry and he says, first you clean yourself, then you come to me. So that is Krishna in 7.20. First you purify yourself, then you come to me. Esham tvantagatam jnanam punya karmanam te dvandva moha nirmukta. But then if the baby is small, the small child says, I am helpless, I don't know what to do. Then what is the mother? Come here, I'll clean you. So that is Krishna in Aham Tvam Sarva Papebhyo Mokshayishyami. You just come to me, I will clean you. I will purify you. Don't worry about that. So this is Krishna's compassion coming out. Then in 18.67 he says, that it's like sometimes, you know, a father has a huge treasure. A father has got very precious jewels, which he has kept for his sons, for his children. But he doesn't tell his children about that inheritance because they may squander it. So now, but when the father feels very, sometimes feels very great affection for the son, and the father takes the son to his treasury, opens the innermost chambers of the treasury, and shows, these are the jewels. And after revealing the jewels, the father may say, don't tell all your sons, all your brothers and sisters about it. So similarly, Krishna says, idam te na tapaskaya na bhaktaya kadachana na chashu shurushave vacham na chamam yobhyasuyati. He says, here I have bared my heart to you. I have told about the innermost secrets of spiritual love. Don't just tell it to anyone and everyone. Why? Because people, if they don't understand, just like the children, may squander a precious legacy. When they grow, the parents' legacy is for the children only. But the children have to grow up, children have to mature so that they will value the legacy and they will use the legacy. So like that, Krishna is saying, those who are not yet spiritually matured, don't tell them about these innermost confidential things. You can tell them about the basic things about you're not the body of the soul. But these are things which should be told carefully. And then in 68 and 69, he is giving various kinds of phalashruti. So he says, those who preach this message, there is no one more dear to me than those people. So he says, Nachatasman manusheshu kashchin me priyakrittamaha. There's no one as dear to me as those who preach this message. Now someone may say, hey, but preaching is very difficult, you know, I can't preach. Krishna says, if you can't preach, then just hear. Just study. He says, if you can't preach, you study. He says, Adishyate chaya imam dharmyam samvadamavayo jnanayakena tenaham ishtasyamiti mehmatihi. You just study. By your studying, you'll be worshipping me with your intelligence and you'll become purified. He said, like somebody has fallen in a well, the rescuer comes and throws a rope. And the rescuer comes and throws the rope and he says, just hold on to the rope, I'll pull you out. Suppose the person who has fallen in the lake says that, you know, I don't have any strength, I can't hold on to the rope. Then this person says, okay, I'll throw a rope down with a lasso around it, with a circular loop around it, just tie it around your waist. And if you just tie it, I'll pull you out. Now this person says, hey, no, but if I tie it around my waist, it will cause so much pain, it will be so tight. So then what that person does is, that person ties the rope to a bucket and sends the bucket down. You just sit in the bucket, I'll pull you out. So like that, first Krishna is saying, you preach this message. And so if you can't preach the message, at least study this message. Somebody says, I can't even study, you know, it's very complicated. Then Krishna says, if you can't study, just hear the message. Just come to classes and hear the message. He says, those who hear this message, they will also become purified. They will also become liberated eventually. And then after that, 18.72, Krishna asks Arjuna, he says, have you become purified? Kachideta shrutam partha tvayeka grena chetasa kachidagyana sammoha pranashtaste dhananjaya. Have you heard attentively? Has your illusion been dispelled? So again, Chakravarti Pad explains that here the mood of Krishna is, Arjuna, if you have not understood anything, I am ready to repeat it. And if you have not understood the whole Bhagavad Gita, I am ready to repeat the whole Bhagavad Gita. I want to make sure that you have understood everything. So Krishna is not just not an official paid teacher who just wants to give the class and go on with one's own life. Krishna wants Arjuna to understand, to be transformed. And if we ask, have you understood, Arjuna? Has your illusion been dispelled? And Arjuna replies in 18.73. Nashto moha smriti labdha. Yes, my illusion is gone. My memory is restored. Tat prasadan maya achyuta. By your mercy, O Achyuta. And Chito smigata sandeha. I am well situated. My doubts are gone. And karishye vachanam tava. I will do your will. I will do your will. In the Bible, when it's described in the Gospels, how when Jesus came to know that he was going to be crucified the next day, so he says that, let thy will be done. And that is a great expression of surrender. Yes, that, you know, if something is going to happen, it's bad, is going to happen, but still, let thy will be done. That is an exalted level of surrender. But the Bhagavad Gita is going further. It is not just let thy will be done, but I will do your will. It is not that whatever is happening, I accept it. Rather, I will do what you want to be done, my Lord. So it's a very exalted level of surrender. And we need to know that surrender is not just stereotyped. See, normally when we use the word surrender, it is like at the end of a war. When a general has no more strength to fight, and surrender, you raise the white flag of surrender. And similarly, we have Draupadi. Now when she's helpless, she surrenders. She raises her hand and surrenders in helplessness. But Krishna tells Arjuna to surrender. Sarvadharman pratyajamamekam sharanam braj. And Arjuna says, yes, I will surrender. But what happens? Arjuna picks up his bow and is ready to fight. So it is not that surrender always means helpless inactivity. Surrender means whatever is the best way we can serve Krishna, we serve accordingly. So for Draupadi, in her situation, surrender means just giving up everything else and leaving the things to Krishna. Arjuna was a Kshatriya, he had the capacity to do things. Surrender means doing wholeheartedly what we can do and leaving to Krishna what we can't do. Our mind makes us exactly do the opposite. You know, we don't do what we can do and we worry about things which we can't do anything about. What we can do, we don't do it. And what we can't do anything, we keep worrying about it. So in that way, I was in New York, so one devotee asked me over there, what is the difference between detachment and irresponsibility? So I said, detachment is after the activity, irresponsibility is before the activity. That means I do the activity properly and then I don't worry about the result. That is detachment. But irresponsibility means I don't care for the activity only. If suppose somebody is cooking for Krishna, I am detached. How much sugar I put, how much salt I put, how much oil, I don't care, I am detached. And if it doesn't taste good, all the people who eat, they will also get training in detachment. This is not detachment, this is irresponsibility. So, Krishna, it's not that Arjuna is unconcerned about what happens. See, detachment does not mean that we are not concerned about the fruits. It means we are concerned about something bigger than the fruits. We are concerned about something bigger than the fruits. Arjuna wants to win the war, but he doesn't want to win the war for the sake of the war. He wants to win the war for the sake of Krishna. So, if he doesn't win the war also, still he has got Krishna. And that connection with Krishna will be his eternal satisfaction. So, when we cook for Krishna, at that time, yes, sometimes the cooking will work out nicely, sometimes it will not work nicely. But if we have done it with a devotional intention, the best effort that we put in, that will please Krishna. And so there is Bhagavad Gita, this is the theme of the second dialogue. One dialogue in the Bhagavad Gita is between Krishna and Arjuna. The outer dialogue, which starts with Dhritarashtra Vacha, he's asking what happened, Dharma Kshetra Kurukshetra. So the outer dialogue is between Sanjay and Dhritarashtra. Now, on hearing Krishna's message, Arjuna's heart is transformed. Arjuna's doubts are dispelled. And he is situated in determination. But the Bhagavad Gita itself demonstrates that even God's message may not transform everyone's hearts. So what Krishna speaks and Arjuna hears, Arjuna is transformed by that. But the same thing Sanjay speaks to Dhritarashtra and Dhritarashtra is not transformed by that. So is it that Sanjay speaking it goes in vain? No. Sanjay describes, he first expresses gratitude, he says, how adbhuta this conversation is in 74. In 75 he expresses gratitude that Vyasa Prasada Chrutvan. It is because of Vyasa's mercy that I was able to hear this. I'm grateful to him. And then in 76 and 77 he says that Rishyami cha puna puna, Rishyami cha muhur muhu. So I'm constantly relishing the remembrance. First he says, Samvadamimam Adbhutam, this wonderful conversation I am remembering and I am feeling ecstatic at every moment. He says, when I remember Rupamatya Adbhutam Hare, the wonderful form of Lord Hari, which Krishna is as Parthasarthi and Krishna as the Vishwarupa. When I remember this, I am filled with ecstasy. So, the Bhagavad Gita itself demonstrates this inner success and outer success. Sanjay is not externally successful. He is not able to change the heart of Dhritarashtra. But he is internally successful. Just by speaking Krishna's message, he becomes spiritually enriched. He becomes spiritually ecstatic. And that is what the Bhagavad Gita's central message is. That it places our destiny within our capacity. The Bhagavad Gita places our destiny within our capacity. In this world, our destiny, our success often depends on things that are not within our capacity. Sometimes our students may not have very good memory capacity, and if the exam success depends on how much you can remember, the students will not be very successful. Now, in this world, so much stock is put on one's physical appearance, how one looks. And if we don't have very good looks, then we may feel that my prospects have become limited. So in this world, often our destiny depends on things which are not in our capacity. But the Bhagavad Gita tells us, in the spiritual realm, our destiny is within our capacity. If we serve Krishna with what we have, as Krishna says, patram pushpam phalam toyam, just offer me a leaf, a flower, just a little water. The acharyas explain that Krishna is not even saying patrani pushpani, not even saying plural fruits and flowers, just one flower you offer, that is also enough. So whatever we have, if we offer to Krishna, even if that offering doesn't become successful externally, even if the external results don't come, internally our heart will become enriched with devotion and we will become satisfied. The Bhagavad Gita ends with the imagery, last verse, yatra yogeshwara krishno yatra partho dhanurdharaha. So wherever there is a geographical question, the Bhagavad Gita begins with the question that dharma kshetra kurukshetra, what happened at dharma kshetra kurukshetra? So Sanjay answers with a generic answer. He says, wherever there is Krishna and wherever there is Arjuna, there will be victory. But the significant imagery here is that yatra partha dhanurdharaha. Arjuna has picked up his bow. At the end of the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, 1.46, Arjuna has cast aside his bow in dejection. Visrujyasa sharam chapam shokasam vignamanasaha. He has put aside his bow. But by hearing the wisdom of the Bhagavad Gita, he has raised his bow and is ready to fight. So Arjuna's bow represents our confidence. It represents our determination. Just as Arjuna, by seeing the armies in the battlefield, he lost his determination, he lost heart. Like that, if we look at the world with our eyes, often adversities, perplexities and problems will dishearten us. We will put aside our bow thinking, what is the point? Why should I struggle so much? What is the point of it all? But when we understand Krishna's message in the Bhagavad Gita, we understand that the point of all is love, undying, immortal love. We are working not just for success in this world. Success in this world will come, it may not come. But if we try to serve Krishna sincerely, we will get everlasting success. Even the smallest of things that we do, Krishna is noting and Krishna will be rewarding. So the Bhagavad Gita, when we understand this message of Krishna's immortal love, no matter externally how discouraging our situation may be, we will become internally inspired to keep reciprocating with Krishna, to keep serving Krishna according to our capacity. Just as Arjuna lifted up his bow, similarly, we too will lift up our metaphorical bow. Our determination will become restored, our confidence will become rejuvenated. And even amidst problems, we'll be able to march ahead in life. Tatra shrir vijayo bhutir dhruvanitir matir mama. So where Krishna, where the soul is united with Krishna, the Bhagavad Gita is of course literal and historical, but it's also poetry, so there is imagery in it. Krishna is present on the chariot with Arjuna. The body is like a chariot, and the soul, we the souls are the passenger in this chariot. In the beginning of the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna was ordering Krishna, do this, don't do this. But by the end of the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna says, Karishye Vachanam Tava. So Prabhupada says in his first initiation lectures, he says, once you take shelter of Krishna, there is no need for you to lament, because you have handed the reins of your chariot to Krishna. So Krishna, we have made Krishna our charioteer, and Krishna will guide us to supreme perfection in life. Unfortunately, we give the reins of our chariot to Krishna, but again we keep taking back the reins. But when we keep coming in the association of devotees, keep hearing, we understand Krishna is in control. Let him be in control of my destiny also. Just let me keep serving him according to my capacity. And as we keep Krishna in charge of the reins of our chariot, we will let that partha sarthi drive us towards the supreme artha, the paramartha of our life. Thank you very much. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki, Shri Prabhupada ki.
It's quite late. We won't have any question answers today. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.